Okay, dann ist es mir jetzt eine ganz besondere...
Hello and welcome to the translation of the talk Mistrustable Security by Peter Shaw. This translation is done by Franz T. and Wolfer 2. Thank you for listening. The presenter used to be Minister for Data Protection. And is now head of some European Academy for Data Protection. Hello, my dear hackers, sirs and madams. I liked to come here. It's not the first time I talk on a Chaos Communication Congress. The first time must have happened like 30 years ago, back in the Bürgerhaus Stelling in Hamburg. That was completely different, especially much fewer people were here, and it was significantly less professional. It wasn't a critic, but in every beginning there is some magic, and so I'm really happy that the community does not just continue to exist, but grew this explosively and continues to grow, because it's all about you when we talk about how the future is going to be. And if you don't participate, you can't complain about the results. Many people in Great Britain noticed this when they woke up one morning after an election where it turned out like it turned out, but not in the way many people wanted it or expected it, but in such a way that, unfortunately for Great Britain, the exit from the European Union is coming. That does not need to happen, and we hope that we don't say the same in Germany, like it shouldn't have happened that way, because there are many ways to change something. And I'm talking about security here. And what does this image I'm projecting here to do with security? It's the title book of a really famous book. It's a book from 1651. It's called The Leviathan by Thomas Hobbes. And this title image is interesting because of many reasons. One of those is there is a man up there, a being that rises up about the landscape. What does this person want to say us? What does it this person mean? Hobbes is the inventor or one of the large discussers of absolute governmental. We have absolute governments. This creature does not only carry a scepter, but also sword. And below the bottom of the image, you can see all the insignias of power. And if you look at it more closely, you see that the torso of this person, we don't see his legs, from many elements. And if you look at it really closely, you see humans there that turn to this leader, to this governor, who submit to this his power. And the important part of this figure is that it is not only powerful, but also protects it. It is recognized as a power of protection, which ensures the safety of those below him. And to ensure the safety the person that demonstrates the absolute state has taken up all the weapons and all the measures of violence, and everybody who does not accept that is, well, in the worst case, will be killed. And this perfect power is not legitimated by elections, but it was selected on by God, as it was said in that time. Above, there is a Latin saying that it does not say, there is no equal power to me. The state having the monopoly of violence, and that was 1651 when that was reasonably close to the end of the 30 Years' War. Here, the peace is restored, but not a peace from the peoples, but from the governors, from the kings. Whoever governs this people, or whoever governs me, I will have to follow his religion, which is part of the saying or part of the laws or regulations that were constituted at that time. The governing persons or the governing bodies accept that, because that what they left behind, this 30 years war, especially in Germany, is something nobody wished upon themselves. We live in 2017, and the year 2017 is the year where a reasonably important German politician said, you can call me a tough dog, defined general rules for a state, strong state in hard times. These rules on the website of the Interior Ministry, he has a quite large number of requests. I will talk about later on, but the security is and the safety is the most important subject, not only for de Maizière, the German Minister for Interior, but also for others. And part of that is that we live in a very frightened society. And if you look at this overview by and it is a fright index all over Germany, you will notice that at the very highest top of the frights of Germany, Germans, is to be victim of a terror attack. Quite a few, more than half of Germans are afraid of becoming a victim of a terror attack. We had terror attacks. We had quite a few victims, like 10 to 15. It's not that certain in the last year. Before that, there were very few. The 10 years before, there were less than 1 year per person. But still, 71% of the of German nationals are afraid of being being a victim of a terror attack. All the other subjects of this of the fright, the political extremism increases. More people come into the country, and they destabilize our society. And apparently, our society is really frightened. That wasn't like that for all the time. If you look at the time and look at the index over time, especially about terroristic situation, you notice that there are significant changes throughout the years. Of course, part of that is that there were frightful attacks, especially in 2001, but even since then, quite a few more. But at the same time, we notice that the fright does not jump up, but only grows slowly with a time lag. Where does this time lag come from? Of course, we can say the media is part of that, but I also it also appears to me that it's not only the media, but also those who give information to the media and those who use the media that lead to more people being afraid. And I put a few of the new rules and new legislation and that have been decided upon since 2001 for the interior security that were decided upon in Germany. And all those, and there are quite a few, like 35, depending on how you count, maybe some more, maybe some fewer, because many of these laws had a number of regulations and they are not evenly distributed. And it is not but it appears that these new anti-terror laws they do not appear to reduce the anger of the people, but they increase it. And maybe there is even a causality there. If whenever we discuss about these new safety laws, the media always talks about these questions, and that appears to lead to more frightened people, because everybody discusses again and again why these new security measures are needed, because everything got less secure. So these new laws for more security safety does not lead necessarily to more safety, but it also leads to more people being afraid, despite everybody saying we want to have more safety and we want to increase the feeling of safety in Germany. We can also discuss that the decisions by judges are part of our safety feeling.
If they need immer stronger laws, then every time there is a decision by the Bundesverfassungsgericht, when these laws are deemed against the German Constitution, then actually the feeling for security should change. I have edited these decisions from the Bundesverfassungsgericht.
Und was fällt dabei auf?
And what do we see? The interesting thing is that with each decision, there is a relaxation of the security feeling of the Germans. That the highest German court, the Bundesverfassungsgericht, says the parliament has made a law which is unlawful. For example, keeping data from telcos was unlawful, and other decisions were deemed unlawful as well. And despite what you would think as a security politician, it doesn't make people insecure, but there is more trust. This means, in that moment where the society is in a large discussion which is not only dominated by security stuff, but also by basic rights, human rights, then humans feel more secure. I think this is a very important message which is overlooked every time. This doesn't stop some people to declare security as a very important super basic human right. This person was once the Minister of the Interior, that is Hans-Peter Friedrich from the CSU. Later on, he was boss of the CSU local group in the parliament. He said that security is a super basic right which dominates every other law. besides that security isn't some sort of basic right, it is important that we want to live in secure circumstances. But security is not based on surveillance, registering people, repression and oppression, but security has a very broad character. And when we talk about security, then we have to talk about social security, we have to talk about security for war, dirt in the environment, and other things which would threaten our existence. But the reduction of the security on, some say it's public security, interior security, that is not enough, that is counterproductive. I also added when this was said. This was just after the revelations from Edward Snowden. That was very interesting. It doesn't really work. But what happened is that there were several attacks and the reactions to the attacks in Europe, which happened in France, in Belgium, and in Berlin. And then, of course, there were decisions. I also added the security packages, correlate them with the constellation of the government, of the parties in government. That isn't really always the same. The most measures were made by great coalitions. That likely is just a random occurrence.
Ich will nur nicht lange mich mit Jamaika aufhalten, denn
I don't want to talk about Jamaica too long, because now it's an island again.
Interessant ist,
but it's very interesting that
bei Jamaika, das
that
hat
Jamaica,
Frau Merkel bestätigt in einem Fernsehen,
even was said by
Mrs.
Merkel, the CDU-CSU wanted to abolish storing connection and metadata. But it won't happen. Now they say they are supporting storing this data.
Gut, es gibt, man braucht immer einen Partner, und da ist
you always need a partner for that. And now the last partner is said that opposition is stupid.
Jetzt nicht mehr ganz,
it's not very correct anymore. We do not know what's going to happen. Maybe there will be another great coalition.
Zur großen Koalition gehören zwei. Ich habe mir deshalb auch angeschaut,
we need two people for a great coalition. What did Sigmar Gabriel say from the Social Democrats? He's an important person of the Social Democrats. He said, what is the position of the Social Democrats? Interesting is that he said, he had the memory of the last great coalition that there is too many postmodern liberal debates, that protection of the environment isn't that important as work, and data protection was more important than interior security. This is really what Sigmar Gabriel said. It wasn't a mistake. That was an article in the German magazine Der Spiegel, and this is where this citation is from, and he repeated this statement. Now you ask yourself, is that something, an issue of memory? Therefore, I checked what did the last Great Coalition in the 2 years, what were their decisions they made in Parliament? They are very different rules or laws which were passed. For example, storing connection and metadata was reintroduced. The BND, the German Exterior Secret Service, is allowed to do what they did before, so it was legitimized. The German Offensive Security Office, CITES, was created, which is supposed to be in Munich, which should provide other government agencies with ODAs for and VULNs, stuff like this. There are many other laws which have been made. The German police can use data for policing, can be used for everything, every aspect of police work. The data from air travels can be kept from 5 years, and there Germany does more than the European Union ever asked for. This is very annoying.
That
in the perspective from data protection, now my successor is not allowed to talk to the parliament when there are issues regarding the secret services. I last did that in 2003, and today it's not possible anymore. It's not allowed. It is incredibly frustrating. Another point, there's a new law for the electronic pass that is supposed to be some EID function in your new ticket pass for citizens. I do not think that is as bad. The annoying thing is that in this law, at the very end, means that all security agencies can access the data of all passes, of all, of every issue of such a pass. There is no supposed to be a central registry for biometric data, but now there is a distributed database with these biometric data or data points. This is much better. Also, the law to improve video surveillance, that is to be read with other laws. 17 of 35 security packages which have been decreed by Parliament are from the last 2 years of the Great Coalition ruling.
So viel zu Sigmar Gabriels Gedächtnis.
So that is all about the memory of Sigmar Gabriel.
So we now have to ask ourselves, what is still missing? What? That's not everything that could happen, just six more ideas, but there are many more things politicians requested, but I only have limited time. So let's look at presumptive data collection. Not only does presumptive data collection is not according to the judgings of the highest German courts and the European courts, European court, and a small German parliament has already decided that it is not lawful, but that does not change anything that somebody thinks about why the courts decided that it was not lawful, but we will still want to increase these laws and these rules. This is Maaßen. He is from consumer protection, and he is a good person, and he would love to get our IP addresses to work against those who endanger our country. He does not want to know who wants to do what on his computer, but he only those who watch videos of where people are killed. But how do we notice who watches those videos? Yeah, well, that's something the interior secret service can't do that, and it's not the German Bundesnachrichten, it's the external service, but we will still have to collect the data within Germany, so we will need to collect the IP addresses. So that's an obvious sign what they want to do in the next great coalition, which is a coalition between Germans two largest parties. And they also, the minister for the interior in Saarland wants to collect all messenger data. And it's just an extension of the already existing laws, and everything is useful. So it's important parts of our laws, especially the security, that are defended by these measurements. Presumptive data collection is one of those regulations that help, because it's good to increase the amount of the hay heap to find the needle inside. And that is something that finally arrived in Germany. We are so grateful that we are also increasing the hay heap. More intelligent video surveillance, that's something I have to agree with de Maizière. The hope that video surveillance has reduces the amount of people who are surveilled if he has nothing to cover. Who goes with who across the station or somewhere else? It's not just about this one station in Berlin where this more intelligent video surveillance was tested, but it was but the aim is to have face recognition in video surveillance more broadly. And we already knew that majority of Germans want that, and the pass and the ID photos are available. But what can we do with that? An Israeli company says that we can recognize terrorists just by their face. And I would love to know how detailed they are. That is supposedly not through databases, but by general face form. And that reminds me to data from from the 18th century, where they wanted to recognize recognize criminals by their face forms. Other things are also clearly recognizable. In this case, whether a person is gay, and also to recognize people who endanger the society, whether that's feasible. The test phase was recognized. The preliminary results promise a large improvement of the cases. So the recognition rate is somewhere between 70% and 85% false positives. So that means those who are not within the file but are still recognized as being within the database, and who also make an alarm, are like 0.3%. That means 480 mistaken alarms per day. If we think about the 160 persons who just are at Bahnhof Südkreuz, where this trial experiment was happening, that means there is a miss alarm all 3 minutes. But if you think about 24 hours, and that's going to be so enjoyable for the police. It's very, very useful and practicable. And we really think that that's unfair, but I still want to do it. I looked into the pilot project in face recognition in Mainz, which is very similar to Südkreuz, and the BKA chef, the German federal police, the chef of the federal police said, I don't want to say that this is good. because it's only useful if it's really close to 100% of people being recognized. And 70 is close enough to 100, so it's great that this will be used all over Germany. And we also want to increase the use of DNA analysis. And this is also part of the paper from the Strong State.
The other citations from Mr. de Maizière: the state must keep up with technology progress in the private sector. That the state needs the access to the private data. They need to have the same status of weapons in a way. And DNA analysis is just part of it. And that is very limited by law right now. It doesn't work at the moment. Both things do not work. That is based on German basic law or the German constitution. The Verfassungsgericht said that a DNA analysis is a very deep dive into privacy, so it needs to be only in very, very serious crime, and we need to think different. We need to think more liberal, says Mr. de Maizière. There, at the moment, we can use it to identify people, but only at very serious crimes. But in the future, that Justice and Interior Minister conferences checked that to check DNA analysis by phenotype, so to what ethnicity does someone belong, what hair color they have. Doesn't really matter if it's a perpetrator. And more and more is added. DNA analytic is getting more easy, more professional, and of course, if you follow this argument of de Maizière, so it shouldn't be only for serious crime. We need to look at it more liberal from his perspective. Travel data, metadata on people traveling, that is really dangerous and interesting, but most threats come from other people, from foreigners, and therefore it is very important that when we travel into other countries or if we leave the European Union, that should be registered. Because I have nothing to hide. And every travel must be registered. Even the US didn't do that for everyone leaving the country. They try to do it when you travel into the country. Donald Trump is also building a nice wall to Mexico in order to track this information, that not as many illegals travel to the US. But what happens if someone is traveling there, but he never leaves? So either there's an error or the person is still there. But what does it mean if the person is still there? That is a very complex system which is going to be in Europe. It has to work 100%. You can spend a lot of money on that. We remember for Sigmar Gabriel that is going to give new jobs. That are synergy effects. Another point is to implement backdoors into IT systems.
Das ist der Einbau von Backdoors in IT-Systemen. Ja, also ich muss wirklich sagen, dass
I really have to say that the police force has it harder. People have security systems at home, but we do have a law which allows surveillance. This means that bugs can be placed in cars, in rooms, can be placed there, and someone has to place them.
But
of course, that's not feasible because there could be an alarm by security systems. And therefore, I think that the alerting system should not be as aggressive.
Ja, ach so, mit dem, das sind jetzt die Mikrofone. Ja, vielleicht gibt es ja auch, sage ich mal,
maybe there are innovative ways to do it. physically hineingehen, so that the police does not have to go into your rooms anymore. So etwas
wird immer einfacher, ne?
That's going to be more easier. We only have to ask the vendors to create backdoors in their products so that the police can access them and surveil and perform surveillance. And they also have CITES is going to provide the exploits for the vulnerabilities. That would be the next step. That is only for very specific cases, very serious crime. There must be control by justice, so that it is only the police and the Interior Secret Service. We know that no one else is interested in that. But I'm not very comfortable with that.
Aller guten Dinge sind sechs, aber wie gesagt, es gibt noch.
The last measure is hacking back.
Ja, das ist ein interessante.
That is a very interesting concept.
Mal zurückschlagen können,
ne? Nicht so in order to strike back.
Nach der Bergpredigt die andere Backe hinhalten,
sondern. But always.
Ne? Also ich finde, das ist.
Provide the other cheek.
Wo man,
that is
wo man
very muss, important.
Das kann man eigentlich unseren Sicherheitsbehörden nicht vorenthalten.
Why shouldn't our security agencies should be able to do that? When German data is accessed by foreign powers. But it should be only used as ultima ratio, it means that's the last measure. At the moment they only collect data, so there would be very few cases. The hackback should be part of the toolkit of our security services, some say. I'm already at the end with an interesting message. The Leviathan is dead or is dying. I'm not really happy about it. The Leviathan ate too much. You do not feel well if you eat too much. Maybe it happened to you. It has been for quite some time, because he took more measures, more executive powers. And therefore, the security the Leviathan is supposed to provide has been lost, has been damaged, because there is not one Leviathan of the on the world, but there are many Leviathans on the world in a globalized society. Think of the server in Malaysia. So the security service have a long arm, also to us, as we know. But here the Leviathans delegitimized themselves. A lot of people do not believe it anymore.
Aber es zeigt uns auf, dass wir alleine auf.
It shows us that we cannot just think of the Leviathan protecting us. As I show you this picture another time, look at the lower part of the picture. What has been left isn't the protection provided by the spread arms, but it is force. And I am worried about it. And it's not only surveillance, it's drones. Drones do not have cameras. Drones which move around out of our borders. I do not have provide additional details. Security is delegitimizing itself. And then I think that there are old informations which are very important, that those who are prepared to give away freedoms, to exchange them for supposed security, they do not provide freedom or security. They do not deserve it. Thank you for your attention.
Some additional information from the translators. Quite a few things were meant to be satirical. To a certain extent, so that is probably has been lost in the translation, and so sorry about that.
Genau, wir haben jetzt noch ungefähr 20 Minuten Zeit für Fragen. Das heißt, falls ihr Fragen habt, dürft ihr euch einfach an einem der 8 Saalmikrofone anstellen. Ich
If you listen live and have any questions and want to ask them, please use Twitter or the IRC channel. You can also ask in English and we'll get a German translation. That should work. Let's start with a question from the internet related.
Should there be changes and the... the stuff the Bundes Data Protection Officer is going to do.
First of all, I have to gender it, also the female Data Protection Officer. But also in the security area, all data protection officers need more rights, and they have to be allowed to go directly to the appropriate parliaments, and they really should have this ability. And the exceptions for the rights of what they are allowed to verify, it's not just security area parts, but also they mustn't look into the health databases, and that's an unacceptable reduction of the abilities of the data protection officer.
Danke für den Talk, Peter.
Thanks for the talk, Peter.
Welches Narrativ glaubst du,
what story helps against this rhetoric of security? Because very often data protection rarely wins
bei so Themen wie Hackback oder
thoughts regarding Hackback,
security disclosure, mehr als IT-Sicherheit versus
but see this as IT security versus physical security.
Weil damit würde man diese Sicherheitsrhetorik übernehmen und sagen,
therefore we would take this security authority
die ihr uns wegnehmen wollt, wenn ihr uns Verschlüsselung kaputt machen wollt,
Zero Days geheim halten wollt. Also do this, you will damage IT security.
Of course, that is a proper begin. Of course, this mustn't be the only idea and the only thing we talk about. This safety promises destroy themselves because they lead to less safety. If we look at vulnerabilities that were kept secret led to German hospitals not being able to continue to work anymore because those previously kept security measures that were known to the secret services, we have to work against that. But we mustn't forget that there are personal rights, and we can only exist as a free person if we are not registered and surveilled everywhere at every step. So both have to be there. Both the request for reasonable security aspects, but also the freedom and the insurance of the freedom for the people.
Okay, thanks for the talk and your work in the last years. Just an addition.
Ich gehe mit vielen d'accord, was du sagst, absolut. Bei deiner Einführung hast du über die
you talked about the terror numbers, the fear of terrorism. I want to add, basically, there's a way to make this more sensible. You do not have to die in order to get a whiff of terrorism. But there were more people who were wounded, because I think this is a difficult way of arguing for it, so use the wounded as well, else great.
Of course, that is a question whether that changes something, basically. Of course, the harm is always larger than those who are physically hurt, and also the frightfulness of the society is far larger than the material damages and also the number of victims that were created by that. That's the target of terrorism, that they get this extended harmfulness. There are reports that say that terrorisms, or at least modern terrorists, choose well video surveilled data, because that way there is video material and that increases the media attention. And in that case, again, video surveillance does not protect against terrorism. And I don't want to go over the victims and how badly these victims have been treated, how insensible, how little empathic that Mrs. Merkel now, after people said, invites them before they were just given formal letters. And this shows that this safety rhetoric it's a bit strange. There are aspects we have to look at again and again, and we have to. We want more security. And if we look at the terror attack in Germany, in Berlin, we know that, especially for quite a few months now, that in this situation, the police did not know enough, but that they were quite blind, and even worse, it appears that Secret Service agents in the area were maybe extensively involved into that. So the attack in Berlin at the Breitscheidplatz is not needed. Many police agencies knew about it, maybe even too many, but they were not intelligent and they did not act appropriately. And if we take those cases where we know that they did not look at, and because of those, if it's argued that because of those cases, all of our data and our private rights is reduced, that's really bad.
Dann machen wir doch an Mikro 6 weiter.
Vielen Dank, großartiger Talk. Gerade die Zusammenfassung, die staatstheoretische, sollte eigentlich Pflichtlektüre
sein. Summary should be forced literature for everyone who reports on that. But what happens in the heads of those talking about security politicians?
Auszuwerten und umzusetzen.
I realize that people do not understand the rulings of the Bundesverfassungsgericht, but what is the understanding of people like Friedrich and de Maizière? Is that a state without borders who requires mass surveillance, because such a state would be totalitarian?
I do not believe that Mr. Friedrich or Maizière is a wants to have totalitarian politics, but they use the assumed opinion of the people and they use that, and that's something that can be easily used in a democracy, even if many people. And that is not only data protectors, people for data protection, but also policemen and Secret Service. They see that and they have a clear view on that. They suggest that things are done. Law does not increase the security or the protection of the people, but it. So what else can Parliament do? They just create a new law. That does not only happen here in Germany, but also in other countries. And that pressures the politics, and there might be other ways to work with those situations. Maybe we should look in the direction of Scandinavia, where a lot of where the people are a lot more careful with these questions, and the people in Scandinavia feel more safe than those here in Germany.
Dann machen wir eine Frage von Nummer 7 und danach 8, bitte.
Ja, Sehr schöner Vortrag. Ich habe auch noch eine Frage dazu.
Great talk. So one question regarding our motto, do something. What is my issue if you leave this place and you try to convince people to do something, that security regarding to fighting terrorism isn't the highest value, then you talk against windmills. You do not make progress. What do you think, what is the development in China with social credits and stuff like that, and if could help to change people's minds? I was at an organization from Handelsblatt. People were totally shocked. And they, everyone said, oh, we are in Germany, everything is fine, because we do have data protection. How do I tell people how dangerous this stuff is?
That's the 100,000 euro question. I like to explain stuff to people and to enlighten people, so we shouldn't make ourselves more stupid than we are, even if people close their ears. But we have to try to reach them, and we will have to discuss with them. We will have to ask them the question, or bring them to ask themselves the questions that are plainly visible. And part of that is, how effective are anti-terror measures, really? Is it more important than other subjects? Yes, it would have been really important to stop the attack at Breitscheidplatz, but it didn't happen. And that was not because there was not enough surveillance, but because many things did not happen in the correct way. And part of that is also to talk about the social credit system of the citizens in China, because the methods, the technologies, the algorithms that are used there are not significantly different than algorithms used here in many areas and more in the government.
Okay, wir haben zwar noch einige Minuten Zeit für Fragen, aber
the police.
Ich muss übrigens 10 hier scharf Schluss machen, ich muss noch zur Bahn.
Genau. Direkt mein Punkt, die Fragen möglichst kurz und präzise machen, damit wir noch möglichst viele reinkriegen. Bitte Nummer 8.
Ja, schönen Dank für den Talk. Du hattest gerade was gesagt von im Vorfeld der Gesetzgebung. Stehen die Presse da?
Before there is a law, everyone says why we want to have this new law.
Dann kommt das
Bundesverfassungsgericht. And then the Bundesverfassung comes along and stops the law. Is that a wrong view that politicians then are more quiet, or what happens?
Yes, they are more quiet for some time, where the preemptive data collection that was stopped first by the German constitutional law and then the European Court of Law, that is not acceptable with the constitution, with the basics laws. And then Charlie Hebdo happened, and then Sigmar Gabriel came. It's really sad that I announce him again, because it was him back then, and he said we need preemptive data collection because we have to protect against things like in Frankfurt, and we looked what happened in France. France had preemptive data collection, and still this unusable argument has been used to introduce preemptive data collection in Germany, and that is something where people press the stop button, but they continue. It is not enough that the constitutional law in Karlsruhe creates these rulings, but we have to learn from that for a long time, and this ability to learn is not equal everywhere.
Damit die Leute von zu Hause auch zu Wort kommen.
Jo, und zwar also, kann man da eigentlich ganz gut anknüpfen, weil
a connection,
die Vorratsdatenspeicherung
because of the von verschiedenen Gerichten keeping data from collecting metadata, is there a way to stop this collection forever?
No, there is no way to stop preemptive data collection for all time. But we will We might have to bring it in front of the court again and again, or maybe even use the political ways. It was discussed again and again, and even the one of the parties, the CDU, CSU, the Union, they even said that we don't want this untargeted surveillance. We want much better, much more targeted surveillance of people who are already seen as possible criminals. It did not happen, and we it is not seen. Yes, we can change it, we can discuss it, but we can't remove all possibilities of something to repeat. So it's important to keep those memories in the back of the mind of people.
My question is, it's creating job. But how does the industry undermine our data protection?
It's quite differentiated. We can see that there is a surveillance industrial complex, but in the USA that's a very well understood problem. It's also here in Germany, which increasing importance this security or branch has. They create their own opinion and their own weight, and that also advances in this us as a society in that area. And in the rest, it's not that clear. With the e-privacy regulations, we discussed that here before. We also discussed how far the sovereignty of each person, the right to one's own data, and to what extent may companies use that data without the acceptance of the people? How far are they allowed to track the user data and the and in Brussels they discuss that quite vigorously at the moment. I hope that they have a good result.
The stuff you showed is not as easy to understand. Are our politicians stupid, or are they having a specific agenda than looking at our security?
Well, I'm quite careful with these agenda questions because it always assumes a secret program. I'm quite skeptical about those theories. So other people talk about, but there are of course many different interests, and in the end, it's all about influence and importance in this society, and that's also very dangerous. But it's something else than if somebody has a totalitarian agenda. And most of our politicians do not see it that way. And you may have a different opinion on that, but I personally am optimistic in this situation, which also means that we can achieve it if we change cultural dreams and feelings. That should also change the agenda of politicians, and that means that the pressure exists and is useful. May it be public pressure, but also over the constitutional jury in Germany, the constitutional, where they discuss our freedom rights.
Last question is going to be, I have the impression that our politicians are just realistic. They are looking at costs and uses, but they do not look at their ideals anymore.
Nutzen von
but very often the use of master wireless was very low and but the cost of making the bad things cost more. How could we do that? That if or do we need to get rid of those politicians?
First of all, I'm not of the opinion that the usage was big. I'm quite contrary to you in that point. And furthermore, the costs of surveillance that they are insignificant is not important. Also, the costs are significant, even if you look at how many policemen and how many surplus hours they have to work off now. They are huge, and if we don't look at it in short term but in a long term view, we also have to look at what kind of society we want, and the use of the society is that we see the freedom, and that also must be on the political agenda. And that's a great finishing word, and with that, thank you for listening to the